Dr. Brent Gloy is an agriculture economist specializing in agricultural finance and agribusiness management. Majority of his research is focused on issues related to supply and demand for credit and farmland values. His research has been quoted and referenced in media ranging from Farm Press to Wall Street Journal, New York Times, The Economist, Bloomberg, Reuters, USA Today, and Barron's, among others. Dr. Gloy founded and served as the first director of Purdue's Center for Commercial Agriculture. He currently works for Agriculture Economic Insights, LLC. He is a visiting professor at Purdue University and operates his family farming operation in southwest Nebraska. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Brent Gloy.
Well, welcome. It's great to be here. What a nice event from Wiffles Hybrids. It's really a garden spot up here, isn't it? What a beautiful farm, what a beautiful place. It's a little bit humbling. I farm in southwest Nebraska and our crops look pretty good, or at least I thought so until I drove up here. Holy cow, you guys have a nice spot to operate. So it's a real pleasure to be here today. You heard about the big news, I guess. Anybody from Ohio here today? Yeah, the earth was shaking in Nebraska, I think, when Urban was suspended without pay. You know, we haven't had a very good football team for a while. I do a lot of these events, and I did one in Nebraska last year, and they raffled off two Husker football tickets. You know, at the start of the meeting, we got two tickets for the Husker game. By the end of the event, there were six of them there, okay? So, anyway, it is great to be here. I'm looking forward to talking to you. I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about what I call the good news, bad news ag economy. And then we will talk about some things you can do, I think, to be proactive in this economy in a situation where, you know, this downturn may last a little bit longer than most of us want. So we'll talk about the reality of that and some things you can do to proactively manage your business in this environment. Just a little about me. After I left Purdue to go back to our family farm, I retained a visiting professorship at Purdue. But when I left, I started a business called Ag Economic Insights. I started out with a guy named David Widmar. Somebody said the other day, is that Chris Christie on there or what? Don't tell David I said that. But we write a weekly column on the internet. It's free. It doesn't cost you anything. You can go get it whenever you want. It comes out every Monday on ag issues. We try and write articles that are easy to read and make a clear point. So we take a lot of pride in that. We've been doing it for 3 years. Check it out if you get the chance. Almost every chart you're going to see of mine in here is on our website in a form of a story. We've written an article about it. So if you're curious about something, you say, I don't believe that, or I want to know more about it, you can go look it up on our website. I also have a farm operation. It's a real farm. Some people, when I moved back, said, well, you're just going to be in an office all the time doing stuff. It's a family farm in every sense of the word. I farm with my parents. I have one sister. She farms, or she doesn't farm. She has no interest in farming. She's a nurse practitioner in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Had no interest in coming back to the farm. And so both of my grandparents homesteaded in southwest Nebraska. All the good land in Illinois was taken by that time. So, you know, we had a long history of farming in that area, and it was kind of Brent or nobody. And my wife and I decided, yeah, I think we'll give that a shot. It's a pretty good opportunity. And we have loved every minute of it. We grow corn under irrigation, soybeans under irrigation. We grow a lot of dryland corn as well, but we're not shooting for anything close to about what you guys are. We get about 22 inches of rain a year is all, and a little bit of wheat, which is what you see up in the upper right corner. I drove all the way up here from St. Louis. I didn't see one field of wheat. And we're going to talk about wheat a little bit here, and you guys are probably wondering, what on earth, what do we care about wheat for? I think there's a lot of reasons to care about wheat. I call wheat the canary in the coal mine. Part of the reason there's been so much pressure on corn and soybean prices is nobody's planting wheat anymore. Wheat's acres are at the lowest we've seen since we recorded wheat acres in the United States. And what does that mean? That land just goes to nothing? No, what are they growing on it? Corn and soybeans, okay? We need wheat to come back to get better corn and soybean markets. the good news is I think that trend may be underway. I will just start by saying, look, there is absolutely no denying there are some really big storm clouds on the horizon. Okay? No question about it. And it starts with trade. In the middle is trade, and at the end is trade, right? We've seen it the last couple weeks. So one tweet can send the market up, and it can send it down just as fast. And so I think the big question everybody's got is how severe, how serious is this going to get? Whoops, knocked my water over. How serious is it going to get, and how long is it going to last? Okay? And, you know, I'm not a fan of what's going on at all. The United States has led the world in free trade for a long time, and we are definitely taking a different tack on it now. But it's reality. Whether we like it or not, it's reality, and we're going to have to learn to manage in that environment. The other big storm cloud, I think, are global economies, and one of them is China. What is the economic situation in China? It seems to be maybe slowing a little bit. There was a big article in the New York Times the other day about how the president there had been critiqued by a professor. Wouldn't want to have that job. Academic freedom in China is maybe a little different than in the United States. You know, I think there's some questions about, you know, how stable are the global economies and what will this trade policy potentially do? I mean, the United States is a huge economy. And when we start changing the rules in international trade, it's going to have reverberations. And it's really hard to know exactly where all the reverberations are going to balance out. The other one is the U.S. economy. We're starting to see, finally, a little bit of inflation in the U.S. economy, and the Fed has been pretty aggressive so far. Well, I wouldn't say pretty aggressive. They've started to raise rates, and they've indicated they're likely to continue to raise rates. And so I think we have to watch that very carefully. And third, I think we have to think about what is the impact of these tariffs going to be on the U.S. economy. And one of the things that we'll likely do is push some inflation, right? It's going to make things more expensive. That we buy from China, okay? And it's also probably gonna have the impact of strengthening the US dollar. So we've gotta think about all those things. But that said, let's get into some of the, let's talk about the production cycle in ag first. Now, Dave and I put this together for one of our customers, our corporate customers. They wanted a description of what the ag production cycle looks like. I'm sorry, it's a little bit out of order in your book. Don't worry, we're gonna get right back on track here in a second. They wanted to know, you know, where are we at in this cycle? Everybody asks, where are we at in the production cycle, okay? Because everybody understands their cycles in agriculture. And we describe it as a couple of key things. Boom periods, margin squeeze periods, recoveries, and stability. Stability is what we spend most of our time in. Stability is a period where we just kind of bounce around. Think late 90s, early 2000s. Times weren't that great. You wanted to know how much money my parents made on the farm, it was real easy. Go to the Environmental Working Group and look it up, right? I mean, that's back when our hats in Nebraska got real curved because we spent all our time looking in the mailbox for those checks. Right? I don't know about Illinois, but that's the way it was in Nebraska. Then they put direct deposit on, our hats flattened back out. It was great, right? It was real easy. Okay? So that's stability. What drives higher prices in stable periods? Weather shocks, right? You get bad crops, prices go up, then what happens? We plant a boatload and we grow a big crop, prices come back down. That's kind of the environment you're in. What dominates in that time period? Cost of production. Get your cost of production low and do a really good job of producing, do an adequate job of marketing, you can do quite well. Then we get the boom periods. The boom, we all know, what was it set off by? Biofuels. Biofuels, a demand shift. What economists say, demand shifted outward. We started putting ethanol into the gasoline supply in the United States in a big way. And that pushed demand out, and it created much higher prices. At the same time, the Chinese economy was booming. 10 plus percentage growth every year. Okay, now the rule of 72, how many of you know the rule of 72? If you don't remember anything else, remember the rule of 72. Rule of 72 tells you how long it takes something to double. So what you do is you divide your growth rate into 72. So if you're growing at 10%, you divide that into 72, that means you're going to double every 7.2 years. Now think about that. The Chinese economy, let's just say it's 10%. It was more than that. Their economic productivity, the economic activity in our country was doubling in 7 years. What about us in the United States? Where are we growing at? 2-3%. How long is it going to take us to double? My kids, how many doubles have they got? Okay? If you grow at 2, it takes 36 years to double, right? So the economy of the U.S. is going to double every 36 to, you know, if we grow really well, maybe 25 years, okay? China was doubling every 10, and they started consuming a lot of soybeans, okay? And that was the boom. Then to top it off, we had a weather shock, a drought. You put a drought, bad production in the middle of that, and you got $8 corn, okay? We were gonna have high prices without the drought in the demand shock. Now, our demand shock has slowed down. So what happens to costs when prices start falling? Well, they don't drop immediately, did they? Remember that? Fertilizer prices actually went up when prices started falling. Okay, it takes a while for things to adjust, okay? But they're starting, and that creates what we call a margin squeeze. Negative profit margins, as far as you can see. That has started to cure itself, okay? We've seen fertilizer prices come down. We've seen farmers put pressure on things like land rents, equipment spending, reducing their costs. That's been very helpful to get us back on track to a period where we can get some stability. The last time we went through one of these cycles was the 70s and 80s. And a lot of you remember that didn't end so well, did it? That recovery period at the bottom can way overshoot. Just like on the upside, it way overshot. In the 80s, it way overshot. Why did it overshoot? A lot of things outside farmers' control. Trade policy. Interest rates. Okay? The economy was in a lot of turbulence. And we talk about interest rates going up now, but in the 80s, we were dealing with double-digit inflation in the United States. So how often is the price of that pickup going to double at 10%? Every 7 years, okay? Lots of inflation. We have not seen anything like that. Now, we're starting to get this trade thing going. That's starting to ring some bells, but there's a lot of differences now as well. I don't think we'll see anything close to like what we saw in the 80s. The 80s was really bad. It was really bad. There were about 100,000 family farms that were technically insolvent in the 80s, and it's simply because they borrowed too much money at the wrong time, and it was out of their control. Things changed completely outside of anything they could do. And so if your operating line credit went to 20%, which some of them did, and you had very much money borrowed on it, what did you do? It was not good. If you survived that and you're farming today, congratulations, I'm serious. That was really, really tough, okay? So I don't think we're in store for anything close to that, but there's gonna be more financial stress if things don't get back to our stability soon. So let's talk about the good news, okay? The good news is that costs of production have fallen significantly, okay? We look at, and I've got the heartland here for corn and soybeans, and I've got wheat in the Prairie Gateway. Now, what we've seen, David and I have been tracking these budgets since 2015 when I left Purdue, and what we've seen is the cost of producing corn has fallen about 70 cents a bushel for a typical farm in the heartland, which is where you're at, of the United States. Now, 70 cents is a lot, and what it means is that back in 15, you needed $5 a bushel to break even, or not quite, but close. Now, and that's an economic break even. Now the number is a lot closer to $4, okay? And for some of you, less. That's good news. That's significant cost reduction. And the thing, the implication it means for you is that we don't need the prices. We don't need $5 corn. If I told you, everybody in this room, you get $4.25 for your corn, how many would be happy? I think almost everybody would be pretty happy. You'd make money at that. Okay? Now, if I told you you're going to get $3.25, how many of you would be happy? I know I wouldn't, okay? I've done that. That's not fun, okay? I've experienced that since I've been back on the farm, okay? The point is, know what your costs are so that when you see prices that give you the chance to make money, act on it. Soybeans down $1.32 a bushel, and wheat down almost $2 a bushel. Now, the really good news, in my opinion, is what's happening in the wheat market. What we're seeing is that globally, we're finally starting to see a potential for wheat stocks to shrink. And that's going to be good news for you here in Illinois if you don't grow any soybeans at all, or any wheat at all, because those darn guys in Kansas and western Nebraska and the Dakotas are going to start growing wheat again. And that's what we want them to do. Our farm traditionally grew a lot of wheat on dry land. How much wheat have I got this year? Almost none. Why? Because if you think the economics of corn production stink, wheat is terrible. Absolutely terrible. We got LDPs 2 years ago on wheat. Now, does anybody know what the LDP price on corn is? It's like $1.79 or something, right? Isn't that what it is? I should have looked that up. It's low. Well, the LDP price on wheat is low, and I collected 30 cents on it a couple years ago. That's how bad wheat was, okay? So how much wheat's being grown? Not near as much as it used to be. We need to shift that back to take some of the pressure off of corn and soybean acres. Because, yeah, our dryland corn doesn't make 250 bushels or whatever you guys are getting here. If we get lucky and do really well, we may get 140, okay? But it's still 140 bushels on a lot of acres, okay? And it adds up. So we want wheat to improve. The other thing to keep an eye on, and this isn't in your chart, I put this in last night, these are our estimates of cost of producing corn. Your heartland is your first set of charts, or your first set of bars here on the left. Okay, the blue dot is what you get if you take the futures prices where they're at when we made this chart. We just blend it out based on when farmers typically sell their grain. That's the price. The orange are variable costs. That's what you spend on fertilizer, seed, fuel, etc. The gray bar is land. That's what you guys have got in it for land costs on a typical bushel. And then the yellow are non-cash expenses. What are those? Think depreciation, family living, family labor, unpaid family labor, all those kinds of things. Now, what I tell people is anytime that blue dot is in the gray, we got problems. Because that means you're not covering your variable costs and your land. When the dot's in the yellow, it's not ideal. We'd love to have it above because that means economic profits. But when it's in the yellow, we do what my dad used to tell me growing up. He says, son, things aren't going real well this year. We're going to live off our depreciation schedule. What on earth did he mean? He meant cash flow-wise, it was okay, but we didn't have any money to replace our equipment, right? We're using it up, yeah, but cash flow-wise, okay. That's the situation we've been in for a while. Now, if you look at wheat, the same chart for wheat, we'd be down that land cost, which means we're not even covering the cost of land, which is really, really difficult. But we're projecting costs to go up a little bit next year based on fuel prices, fertilizer, et cetera, okay? Now, this soybean thing is a huge wild card because if soybean prices don't come up, what's going to happen next year? You all are going to plant a boatload of corn, and so is everybody else. And that's going to do what? Drive up fertilizer prices, because how much fertilizer do beans use relative to corn? Not nearly as much, right? So I think there's some potential for some cost increases this year. What about equipment costs? What do you think those are going to do? Already starting to see some of those get hiked up. So I think there's potential for some cost. You want to watch that very carefully going into next year, where your variable costs are at, where your fixed costs are at. Second good point, the global acreage expansion has lost significant steam, okay? And this is really important, okay? Because if you look at global, this is global acreage over last, since 1960, and what you see are some really key points in here. There is a point in time here, we kind of were flat, and then we build up. Okay, right here, what's going on? What year is that? 1970, what happened there? Another Purdue professor got really famous. He became Secretary of Agriculture. He went to Moscow, and he made a deal with our arch enemy, the USSR, and he did what? Sold him the entire US grain reserve. He came home and he said what? What should American farmers do? Plant fence row to fence row. His name was Earl Butts, okay? And did they? Yes. Did the South Americans get involved in the game? Yes. Saw a big run up in acreage, and then all of a sudden it stopped. Huh. Why did that stop? Because if you're an economist, and they teach this at Purdue, this is how you learn how to forecast. We love lines like that, because how do you forecast it? You put a ruler on it, and you just draw the line out there. So there we were all forecasting acre, just keep going like that, and it stopped. Why? What year is that? 1980. January 4th, I believe. Jimmy Carter, the Russians had invaded Afghanistan, I think, in December of 1979. Jimmy Carter announces a grain embargo against the USSR. What happened to prices? Dropped significantly. What else was going on? Okay, lots of inflation in the economy. Shortly thereafter, a guy named Paul Volcker became chairman of the Federal Reserve. He said inflation stops when? Today. And people said, yeah, right, you can't do that. He said, yeah, I will. I'm going to take interest rates as high as they have to go to stop it. And how high did they get? Well, up to 20% for some of you on operating lines of credit. Significant increase in financial costs, and we had a stop. And that went on for a long time. Remember that stability period that I talked about? Here it is in global acreage. Then all of a sudden, we start going up again. What's going on? What year is this? About 2004. What's going on there? Somewhere in that time frame, George Bush walked out of one of his State of the Union speeches. He stopped. He saw a senator from Iowa. His name's Chuck Grassley. He said, was that enough for you? What was he talking about? Just proposed a renewable fuel standard. Okay? And away we go. Now, the key point, in the United States, what did we do? We reduced the acreage in CRP, so we brought some land in there. Now, I know it's all out where I live. It's not nearly as productive as this, but still produces something. Second, if you produce something, you have a factory, and your stuff's in demand, what do you do first? You go out and build another factory? No, you invest. You modernize your current factory, and that's what we did in the United States. We tiled. We irrigated. We did everything we could do to make our land as productive as possible. So we made our factory hum. South America, on the other hand, built a new factory. Average acreage 9904 versus 13 and 18. In South America, they added 78 million acres. Now, that's just a big number, right? And we heard what $1 quintillion will do a little while ago. Well, what's 78 million acres about the same size as? About as many bean acres as we plant in the United States typically, a little bit short of it. Think about that. 15 years, they added that much production area in South America. It's crazy to think about. It's hard to get your head around, but it happened. Now, the good news is it's starting to lose steam. My biggest worry is this tariff situation is going to do what? It makes... The total quantity of soybeans traded in the world is going to be similar, okay, as to what it was. What do the tariffs do? They make beans more expensive in China, right? So on net, they're going to want a little bit less on the margin, and they're going to make them more expensive for the Brazilians, right? Their prices are going to go up. What's going to happen to ours? They got to go down, because our beans don't get to go, as much of them get to go to China as they used to. And when you disrupt that trade pattern, all things equal, it's going to make them a little less attractive. So we got to discount prices. And so my biggest worry is it incentivizes acreage expansion in South America in the long term, which we do not want. Demand is robust, though, for ag commodities. Here's soybeans. Look at this. 50% of our soybean crop we export. It's a huge amount. And look at China. Domestic consumption in yellow, domestic consumption in gray bars, and share of global imports on the right. Globally, they import about 65% of the world's soybeans. Unbelievable growth story. That's awesome. That is awesome. The demand story, I think, is still there. Demand is really robust, okay? And that's good. Don't forget about that. Fourth, global grain stockpiles are shrinking. We actually planted fewer acres of corn this year. All right, that's good, right? Gave us a chance to get in a situation where we got some higher prices. Now, just so turns out, we have another pretty good production year, right? We may not shrink them as much as we want, but that wheat one, if I updated this chart, that thing is starting to go the other way. Because production in wheat, they're experiencing their problem, okay? So I think there's good news around demand and supply. We got to get the trade thing out of the way. The not so good news. Working capital has evaporated. Okay, this is working capital in the U.S. farm sector. It peaked at about $165 billion. Today, it's less than 60. Something like a 67% decrease in working capital in the farm sector. That is significant, okay? Just last year, went down another $18 billion. Okay. Big, big declines in working capital. I know this is a sector level. Every farm's different. But you got to bet that a lot of the farms look the same way. And if you're in this position, this is something we have to monitor very carefully. What is our liquidity position? What can we do to improve it? How can we hold on to the working capital we have? Because bankers are going to ask some tough questions this fall for some of us. Debt is up. Okay, this is real U.S. farm debt. And yeah, real debt didn't quite go up last year because inflation was more than the percentage increase in debt, but it's high. We've added a lot of debt in the last 15 years to the farm sector. Okay? There's no denying that the numbers are right there. Now, are we over too much debt? I don't think so, but that's an individual situation. Some farms, probably so. So it's something to really watch carefully, because if we're in that period of stability, remember, we're on thinner margins than we've been for a while. We got to watch this very carefully. Income is way down. Okay, so liquidity has decreased, debt's up, income is down. Now, this is U.S. numbers. You see Heartland, this is just 17 to 18, we're down 6%. Every place on here is less income. Not a good combination, okay? Here's net business cash income by commodity, and I put a box around corn and soybeans. I compared what we're at today versus the average from 2010 to 2015 and versus the highest we had in 2010 to 2015. Now, look at this. Corn, net cash income is about 68% of what the average was over that time period. So a lot less. Soybeans, a little bit better story there. I mean, hey, you could be wheat, 25%. That's bad, okay? The only one on here that's really done okay is cotton, and that's just because it stunk for a while, okay, in that time period. So income is down almost every commodity group is feeling the pain. It doesn't matter if you're in livestock, you name it, okay? So this is just the reality. The other thing that I think is going to be tough is the government payments are really low relative to what they've been in history. These are real government payments over the last, since 1970. What you see is today, we're under $10 billion. That is a level we have not seen since back in the 80s, early 80s, before the government started pumping significant money into the farm sector. ARC payments are going to be how much this year? Try zero, okay? Just put that into your budget, okay? ARC payments are going to be zero, and most of us are signed up for ARC, okay? Now, hopefully we get the chance to switch, but right now, that program's not going to pay much. Now, Mr. Trump has offered us potentially, maybe another $7 billion, but who knows how that's going to be divided. There's lots of uncertainty on who's going to get what, how much, can't really plan on that. Even with that, it'll just get us back up to levels, you know, we've seen for a while. So what's my point? This is reality. The government is not going to bail us out of this thing. The government is not going to provide near as much income as it did back in the last times we had trouble. So we've got to figure out how to manage through it. Okay? Debt service. This is the debt service ratio on the bottom left, it times interest earned ratio on the top right. Debt service is climbing. In other words, it's taken more of our production to service the debt. Keep in mind, about half the farms in the United States have no debt. Okay, farms. I mean, most of us in here are commercial farms, and we count a whole bunch of others that aren't, okay? But reality is debt service is increasing. As interest rates go up, what's going to happen to that? It'll get more tough. We are nowhere near kind of critical levels that we saw back in the 80s, but it's something to watch carefully. So what do we do? This is my daughter, Jacqueline. And Jacqueline is a master strategist. I mean, she's destined to be CEO of Wiffles or something someday because she is good. She knows what she wants. She knows how to get it. And she had a problem. Dear Tooth Fairy, I don't know where my tooth is. I was eating ice cream and I don't know where my tooth went, but it was gone after the ice cream. Will you still give me the money? Okay? And she knew, she left that letter for Dad, or the Tooth Fairy would deliver, right? And they did, okay? So it worked, but we can do better than the Tooth Fairy. The other thing I got to deal with is my kids are getting to that age where the Tooth Fairy is no longer kind of believable. Dear Tooth Fairy, please sign your name on the lines below, okay? So they're getting pretty dubious of the Tooth Fairy. Anyway, so what are we gonna do? The first thing I challenge you to do is work on some of the hard stuff. We've got to fix our cost structure. This pie graph, I couldn't figure this out. Like, what do we do? I gave the problem to my son. He got on his computer. He popped out the pie chart. He said, Dad, the answer is in the pie chart. I said, what do you mean? He says, this is where farmers spend their money. Okay? That pie chart. We spend about 26% on variable costs. Fertilizer, seed, and pesticides. Other variables are 14. That's for us, my farm, that's irrigation. Machinery is another 16, land is 35. Now, if you're a farmer, you got a budget problem, what's the first thing you do? I know, I'm a farmer. We have a place in town, it's called the Shack. It's like an adult club, right? You know, a good old boy club. We go down there and talk and we complain. If you have a budget problem, you go down to the Shack and you complain about it. And the first question that comes up was, well, how much do you pay for your fertilizer, right? And if that fertilizer, you find out your neighbor got it cheaper, what do? You grab a big stick, you walk down to the fertilizer dealer, and you whack them with it about five times, you see if some money falls out, right? And that's how we attack the budget problems in the first stages. How's that gonna work for us? Almost everybody in here, you're buying that stuff as good as you're gonna get it. I mean, I can't hit them anymore and get anything out of them, okay? I'm getting that bought as good as I can, and most of you are too. So what's that mean? We gotta look other places. Where we gotta look? Machinery, We got too much iron in the industry, and we have to figure out how to get our machinery costs down. And land. Oh, that's the one we don't like to talk about, right? Because nobody wants to give up that farm or try and get that rent. I mean, we want to try and get the rent down, but it's hard, right? I know. I've rented some land. Those are tough conversations, right? We walked away from a farm we've been renting for 25 years. It was a good farm. It just didn't make sense anymore. We had to raise too good a crop and sell it at too high a price to make any kind of money. That's a tough decision. Okay? I understand it. I get it. But that's what we got to fix. Those are hard ones, and you can't fix them overnight. Here's machinery cost investment for Kansas farms. And so, you know, we thought we'd see some kind of a relationship here. And this is work Michael Langmeyer and Greg Eibendahl did. And each dot is a combination of farm size on the bottom and investment on the top. You see any relation there? Any pattern? Did this in Missouri? Guy goes, yeah, it's a great pattern for shooting ducks, right? Hey, no, it's all over the place. So all I will say is I guarantee you this guy at 2,000 acres has got way too darn much machinery investment. We need to know what that is for our operation. Are we doing this as efficiently as we can? Do we have too much capacity? Can we work with a neighbor? Are there other things we can do to get our machinery cost per acre down? This is a big driver, and this is a hard problem because it means big changes. I know our operation, I could switch. I could change my row configuration and probably reduce my cost. But it's a big cost to do that, right? It's a big bullet to bite to do it. And we didn't want to do it because we've got more capacity right now than we need. And everybody wants to do what? Get bigger. But how much are we paying for that? And you got to figure that out. We got to figure out, you know, where the balance is at and get your machinery costs down. The other one is land rent. We have any Indiana people in here? Any Boilermakers or Hoosiers? Good, this is Indiana Day, so I can say whatever I want about them. This is the expected return to farmland as a percent of cash rent, and it's average quality Indiana farmland. Now let me just explain this chart really quickly. If that number is 100%, it means at budget time you expect to pay all your expenses and get 100% of your rent back, make zero economic profit. Anytime that's more than 100%, we're looking at economic profits. That happened. Man, those were good days, weren't they? 200% means you get a whole nother rent check back, pay your rent and get a whole nother rent check to put in your pocket. Hey, that's good. What's that number now? Well, it's at least headed in the right way. It's about 20%. What's that mean? These are subsidizing 80% of the cost of land out of our pocket. Now, I know Illinois farmers are smarter than Indiana farmers. That's not happening here, is it? Yeah, right. I know. This happens in Nebraska too. Land rents have got to come down. You got to pay for the right land, pay the price for the right land, really understand what it is. But when you look at it on average, it doesn't make any sense. Second, embrace data, technology, and information. The one thing I guarantee, and I think you picked up on our last speaker, is in 5 years from now, you're going to use more data, more technology, more information than you use today. And we're small businessmen, and there's a lot of stuff coming at us, and we've got to figure out how to partner with the people that can help us make use of that information and do a better job with it. Pursue good deals with discipline. Let's ask everybody, what's your plan, investment plan on your farm? Do you have a priority list? My next capital investment is going to be what, and how much is it going to take? Have a priority list so that when the good deal comes along, we don't just take it. We spend it where it has the biggest return in our operation. On my farm, it's grain storage. I can tell you right now. And it may be different on yours. Okay, but for our operation, that's where our highest return on capital is going to be in the next so much time. The other thing I use is this Poor Man's Guide to Markets. And this is from a guy named Howard Marks. And he wrote a book called the most important thing on common sense for thoughtful investors. And what he does is he says, look, I used to use this when farmland prices were going up. What he does is he says, look at these factors. Is the economy vibrant or sluggish? Is the outlook positive or negative? Are lenders eager or maybe a little reticent, and so on? He says, go through this list. Start circling them. And what you do is if you want to buy something like farmland and you find that all the circles are on the left, put your money in your wallet and go home, right? Think back to 2012. Were the markets crowded or not? Were there very many sellers? No, there weren't. Land prices, if you wanted to go to an auction, you had to get there early, get a seat, right? Everybody wanted it. Okay? That is not the time to buy capital assets. When's the time to buy capital assets? When nobody else wants them. I bought a farm last year. Okay, I went to the auction. I mean, I'll tell you what, I'd done all the numbers. We figured out what it was worth. We go to the auction, guy starts calling, there's nobody there. The bankers are in the room beforehand. Oh, God, I don't know why anybody want to buy this farm. You can't make any money, it's terrible. I mean, it was the most negative attitude I've ever seen. It was a pretty good farm. And I start asking for bids, and my dad's looking at it, going through full first round, never even got a bid. My dad looks and he says, what are you doing? I thought you said it was worth this much, you can bid on it or not. I said, yeah, I guess you're right. My wife's like, so I bid, got the opening bid, go through a whole nother round of bidding, nobody else bids. And I'm sitting there going, oh God, I made a huge mistake. I shouldn't have done that. What? I'm an idiot, right? Feeling terrible about it. My wife's like, you said it was worth way more than that. What are you doing? Some guy finally starts bidding against me. She's like, you said it was worth way more than that. You better get to bidding. So I bid a couple more times, I got it. And I felt a little bit nervous. Now, 3-4 years ago, I would have bought that farm. Wow, I felt awesome, man. Oh, man, I rocked it there. We got a good one. I bought one a couple years ahead of that, paid way more for it. Which one's got a better chance of working? The last one, okay? And what do you think grows on that land normally? What crop? Wheat. Why? Because nobody in their right mind would buy a wheat farm right now, right? Well, it's going to change. So all I'm saying is you got to be disciplined, use your head, not your emotions. I bought that farm and I thought, you know, the other one I bought paid 40% more for. I felt good about that one. I felt bad about this one. That's backwards thinking. We are wired wrong. I'm running out of time, so I want to just say a couple things about price risk. Look, price swings are part of agriculture. We all know it. We got to take advantage of it, okay? And the first thing is understand what your cost difference is. And we are on the knife's edge of profitability right now. Little changes make a big difference in profitability. Just ask yourself, how did you feel 3 weeks ago when prices were really low? Not very good, right? You're kind of going, geez, this is going to be tough, right? 320 cash corn on our farm, that's tough. How'd you feel a couple days ago when it was back up? A lot better. If you felt a lot better, we need to act on some of those. If you have a marketing plan, you don't act on it. I've done this for 3 years. I got a marketing plan. Man, price is going to, I'm going to wait. Don't get it done, right? You got to find a solution to that. Ask yourself why you're not doing it. Well, I don't know if I'm going to have it. Yeah, well, what's the worst that's ever happened on our farm? Let's take a look at that and do what I did. Give it to my wife. She nags on me all the time anyway, right? Did you get it sold or not, right? Your plan said you're going to sell it. Did you do it? Get some accountability built into your system. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and close. I wish we had more time to talk about that, but we don't. So one last point. One of the reasons we don't act on our marketing plans is we create a lot of bias. And last year is a perfect example of that. Think about Twitter. Man, everybody on Twitter, it's all, oh, my crop's burning up. It looked terrible, right? And what did we harvest? A near record crop, okay? I turned that off this year. I don't even look at it anymore because I don't want to know, okay? Because the reality is David did a really interesting study. He said, how many acres of cropland in the United States are suffering from yields are going to be 85% or 85% of their trend every year. And what he found is really interesting. On an average year, 10 million acres of corn in the United States are going to have yields less than 85% of their trend. That's a lot. Think the size of state, size of Indiana. Okay, and what does social media do? It amplifies it. And so we can always look on there and confirm the bias we have is, man, my crop stinks and prices are going to have to go up. So try and remove those biases from your thinking. So with that, it's been great talking to you guys. I think the future is actually bright for agriculture. It's really bright, just like the last guy said. What we've got to do is make sure we make it to that bright future. And that requires discipline on costs, land, and machinery, getting those costs down, and marketing your crop at prices where you can actually make money, not hitting home runs all the time, to make it to the time when we get better prices. So with that, you've been a great audience. I've enjoyed it, and I wish you all the best luck, and thanks for having me. You're a beautiful part of the country.